Today we will discuss about status epilepticus. We will see some of the definitions in seizure. So what is the definition of seizure? It's a paroxysmal event due to abnormal and excessive hypersynchronous discharge from an aggregate of CNS neuron. It's an excessive hypersynchronous electrical discharge from the CNS neuron is a seizure. Epilepsy is it is a condition where the patient can have recurrent seizures, that is called as epilepsy. Third one is convulsion. Convulsion is the motor component of seizure. So remember three things: seizure is a hypersynchronized electrical activity from the brain. Epilepsy is repeated seizures, you call it as epilepsy. Convulsions are the motor activities during seizure. Now we'll see what is the definition of status epilepticus. Status epilepticus is defined as a seizure activity which prolongs more than 5 minutes or a series of seizure activity without return of full consciousness, you call it as status epilepticus. So more than 5 minutes continuous seizure or in between two seizures, if the patient is not regaining consciousness, you call it as status epilepticus. We'll classify now status epilepticus. Okay, so there are three major classification: convulsive status, non-convulsive status, neonatal status epilepticus. In that, we'll discuss two things now. Convulsive status again classified into generalized tonic-clonic status, GTCS status, or partial epilepsy which is continuously occurring. Okay, it is called as epilepsia partialis continua. Okay, non-convulsive status, two major classes are there: absent status, complex partial status. Another class is neonatal status epilepticus. So classification is mainly three: convulsive status, non-convulsive status, and neonatal status epilepticus. Now we'll see what are the causes for status epilepticus. The major cause for status epilepticus is patient has not established properly. Patient has not taken anti-epileptic drugs like last 2-3 days. That is a major cause for status epilepticus. Other causes like patient might have taken alcohol. Binge alcoholism can produce seizures, continuous seizures, or acute brain like brain injuries. Like it can be due to tumor or metastasis or trauma or stroke. Anything can produce subarachnoid hemorrhage. So many things can produce status epilepticus, which produce some injury into the brain and produce status epilepticus. Other major causes which come to emergency room is metabolic abnormalities like hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia. Both can present with status. Hepatic encephalopathy, pyridoxine deficiency, hyponatremia, and hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, all these things can produce status epilepticus. Okay, some drugs can produce status epilepticus, like penicillin or quinolones or antidepressants. So many drugs can produce status epilepticus. Okay, so the major cause is always missing the tablet. Missing anti-epileptic is the major cause. Then alcohol, brain injuries, metabolic abnormalities, some drugs also can produce status epilepticus. Now we'll see what are the investigation we have to do in emergency room in a case of status epilepticus. Okay, the major investigation, whenever the patient entering to emergency room, you see what is the saturation of the patient. Okay, oxygen saturation is most important. You take an ABG also to know what is the acid base status of the patient. The next investigation will be, you will be doing a glucometer RBS. This is very important because many patients with status epilepticus can have hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia, or both hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia can induce status epilepticus. So blood sugars are very, very important. Then you will check for the electrolytes. You can get hyponatremia can produce status, hypocalcemia can produce status, and status epilepticus itself can produce abnormalities in the potassium. A status epilepticus continuously occurring for some time, it can produce rhabdomyolysis and hyperkalemia. And early phase of the status epilepticus, you can have potassium depletion, hypokalemia. So many electrolyte imbalances are seen in status epilepticus. Okay, then you check serum calcium, sodium, magnesium, all these things, phosphorus, and you have to do liver function test, renal function test, any infection screen mainly in the brain, CSF study should be done. Okay, then you ask for a drug screen, whether patient has taken any drugs or not, and you have to see anti-epileptic drug levels in patients or those who are already on anti-epileptic drugs. You should know the drug levels of the anti-epileptic drugs. Okay, And if required, you have to go for a CT or MRI brain. That is only if you have a clinical suspicion of infection or trauma or bleed. Okay. EEG is the last thing which cannot be done in emergency room. It should be done in a ward patient. Okay. So these are the basic investigation. Don't forget to take a blood sugar in any case of status epilepticus. Okay. Now let's see how we manage a status epilepticus in emergency room. Like any other patient, we have to take care of the airway, breathing, circulation. Okay. So once the patient entering to ER, you put the patient on a bed and clear patient's mouth. Okay. So you remove the secretions, artificial dentures, all these things, tongue fall should be cleared. So the mouth should be cleared so that patient will not aspirate or patient will not have asphyxia. Okay. Clear the mouth is very important step. Okay. Then start oxygen if there is hypoxemia. Okay, then next one is monitor EEG and blood pressure, because some patients can have hypotension and ECG abnormalities. So you monitor ECG and blood pressure. Okay, put two IV lines because you may require IV fluids and you may have to give intravenous drugs. Okay, next, any patient who is having status, you don't know the history properly, you start him on thiamine. That is 100 mg in dextrose. Okay, so thiamine and dextrose can be given in all patients. It is not a proper indication, but you can start in any patient who is having seizure. Okay, so give thiamine and dextrose. Next, suppose the patient has recovered from the acute seizure, you can put the patient on left lateral position to prevent aspiration. Okay, so remember, once the patient is not having seizures, always put the patient in left lateral position so that patient will not have aspiration. Okay, so left lateral position is very important. Suppose this patient is continuously seizing. Okay, you have seizure without a stop. That's why we call it as status epilepticus. Okay, continuous seizures. Okay, the first drug should be given in status epilepticus is lorazepam. Okay, so IV lorazepam 0.1 to 1.5 milligram per kg body weight can be given in the first dose. It acts for 4 to 6 hours. So 0.1 to 1.5 milligram per kg lorazepam is the first line of drug in status epilepticus. Additional doses of lorazepam can be given, or you can give infusion at a maximum rate of 2 milligram per minute. Okay, so lorazepam should be given as an initial step to control the seizure. Okay. There are some alternatives for lorazepam. If you don't have lorazepam, you can give IV diazepam. It's a little long acting drug, 0.1 to 0.3 milligram per kg body weight, it can be given. Or you can even midazolam, it's a very short acting drug, 0.2 milligram per kg bolus followed by continuous infusion of 0.75 to 10 microgram per kg per minute can be given. So you can give lorazepam, you can give diazepam, you can give midazolam. All these things has got a equal effectiveness. Current recommendation shows lorazepam is the better drug among all these three things. Okay. Now suppose the seizure is not stopping after 5 minutes. You tried lorazepam first dose, you can repeat one more dose of lorazepam. So lorazepam second dose may be the same dose, 0.1 to 1.5 milligram per kg, second dose can be given. If that does not stop the seizure, then you have to go for definitive therapy. Definitive therapy is, first line drug is fosphenytoin, IV fosphenytoin 20 milligram per kg. Remember 20 milligram, that is very important because every drug will have 20 milligram per kg dose. Okay, IV fosphenytoin 20 milligram per kg, infusion rate is 150 milligram per minute. So fosphenytoin 20 milligram per kg, it should be given in 150 milligram per minute. Okay. So advantage of fosphenytoin over phenytoin is it can be given very faster, for faster than phenytoin, and it can be diluted in normal saline or dextrose. Okay. So fosphenytoin is a first line anti-epileptic drug in status epilepticus after initial bolus dose of lorazepam. Okay. So fosphenytoin can be given. Phenytoin is an alternative drug. Previously phenytoin was the first line drug. Now fosphenytoin is a better drug. It has got a better side effect profile. Arrhythmias are less. So we are using routinely phosphenytoin 20 milligram per kg infusion, but phenytoin is an alternative. IV phenytoin 20 milligram per kg infusion, it should be given in normal saline at the rate of 50 milligram per minute. Okay, so only thing, two things you should remember: it should be given in a slower rate, it should be diluted in normal saline, dose is same, 20 milligram per kg weight infusion. Okay, suppose the seizure continuing, you are given phosphenytoin first dose or phenytoin first dose, seizure is continuing, you can even repeat the dose of phosphenytoin. So another dose of phosphenytoin, IV phosphenytoin 20 milligram per kg, and infusion can be given in the previous rate, 150 milligram per minute can be given. Okay, so phosphenytoin can be given a repeated dose, or you go for sodium valproate, that is around 20 to 25 milligram per kg. But you remember, everything is 20, so sodium valproate should be given 20 to 25 milligram per kg body weight initially, that can be given. Or you have a better drug or better side effect profile drug, that is levetiracetam. Levetiracetam is nowadays mainly using in patients who is having liver disease with seizures. Okay, so it does not alter the liver function test. So levetiracetam can be given in patients who is having liver disease, or it can be used as a second line drug in any patients who is having seizure. So levetiracetam dose is 40 to 60 milligram per kg body weight can be started. Okay, so you can either second dose as a second line of drug, you can give repeat the phosphenytoin in a previous dose, or you go for sodium valproate 25 milligram per kg, or levetiracetam 40 to 60 milligram per kg, that can be given. Okay, suppose the seizure is not controlled, it is continuing, then you have to go for another drug, that is phenobarbital. Again 20 milligram per kg body weight as should be given as a bolus, and the infusion rate of that bolus is 60 milligram per minute. Okay, so phenobarbital can be given 20 milligram per kg infusion. Okay, another drug which can be given in acute setting is IV lacosamide. Okay, 200 to 400 milligram IV bolus with a maintenance dose of 200 milligram is the dose of lacosamide. Okay, so you can give either phenobarbital or lacosamide in acute settings, status epilepticus. Okay, if the seizure is not getting controlled, then you can repeat phenobarbital 10 milligram per kg at 60 milligram per minute, infusion can be started. Okay, so phenobarbital, if required, second dose can be given in status epilepticus, but normally we don't give that because better drugs are available. Okay, again your seizure, the patient's continuously having seizures, and you are not able to control with the previous three drugs, now you have to admit the patient to ICU and you sedate the patient fully with midazolam infusion. So midazolam infusion, again you can give 0.2 milligram per kg body weight, you load, and followed by 0.75 to 10 milligram per kg body weight minute, infusion should be started. Okay, so initially we were giving stat dose, now we'll have to give continuous midazolam. It's a short acting drug, repeated injections may not be enough, you have to give infusion. Okay, and you can give the patient with propofol 2 milligram per kg load, followed with 30 to 250 microgram per kg per minute infusion. Okay, so you can go for midazolam with propofol infusion, or you can give ketamine IV. Ketamine 1 to 2 milligram per kg over 30 to 60 seconds can be given. That is another drug that is a useful drug in status epilepticus. So all previous drugs have failed, now we have gone for midazolam with propofol, intubate the patient, put him on ventilator, because continuous seizure activity can damage the brain. Okay, because whenever you have seizure, the blood supply or oxygen supply to brain is reduced, and if you have continuous seizures, patient can have hypoxemia. So we have discussed some points, like initially when the patient come to emergency room, clear the throat, clear the oral cavity, put the patient on left lateral position if the patient is having risk of aspiration. If the seizure is not controlled, you start with lorazepam. If the lorazepam patient is not getting controlled, you can even repeat the dose of lorazepam. Then if the seizure is not getting controlled, you go for phosphenytoin 20 milligram per kg body weight, bolus dose should be given. Phosphenytoin dose can be repeated. Instead of phosphenytoin, you can try phenytoin also. If the phenytoin or phosphenytoin fails, you go for phenobarbital. If the phenobarbital fails, again you sedate the patient with propofol, ketamine, or midazolam infusion, ventilate the patient, admit to the ICU. So we have discussed basic management of seizures in normal settings, but in eclampsia it is slightly difficult, slightly different, the treatment is slightly different. Instead of all the previous drugs, we use magnesium sulfate in eclampsia. 6 gram bolus over 15 minutes is the dose of magnesium sulfate in eclamptic seizures, and then 1 to 3 gram per hour continuous infusion. You have to check the knee jerk in the patient during magnesium sulfate infusion. So magnesium sulfate infusion is that, or it's the treatment for seizures in eclampsia. Other treatment also can, other drugs like phenytoin also can be tried, but magnesium sulfate is the main treatment. Thank you.